In August, President Trump's nominee for the Supreme Court, Amy Coney Barrett, delivered a ruling in which blocked workers from suing their employees when tech companies deny them overtime compensation.
So that ruling revolved around Grubhub delivery drivers' allegations that the company broke federal law by refusing to provide them with overtime pay. Here to discuss Barrett's record and that ruling in particular is friend of the show and research director at the American Economic Liberties Project, Matt Stiller. Great to see you, Matt.
Good to see you, Matt.
Good to see you guys.
Mm-hmm. Just break down this particular ruling for us and what the potential implications are.
Yeah, so this is a really good example of the real stakes of the Supreme Court, which is largely business law. So you would think that if you are just an ordinary person in America that you could sue if somebody cheats you or steals from you, and you would be able to sue in a court. But since roughly the 1980s, we have these things called arbitration agreements, where powerful corporations can stick an arbitration agreement into a contract, like a something you click on screen, and then they can take you to an arbitration, not a court, where they're actually paying for the arbitrator. It's all secret, and basically you always lose. Well, the courts have over time, and the conservatives have been more aggressive on this than the liberals, but it's been bipartisan, but largely it's the conservatives lately, have been saying, yeah, actually, there's nothing that any consumer or worker or anyone else can do. You just don't get your day in court. And so Barrett ruling against gig workers who were not granted overtime pay is just standard. It's just taking away people's rights to actually get access to the court system when they've been cheated.
Mm-hmm. Matt, so the pushback that I've heard on this, which is, you know, from a populist right perspective, is, look, the Supreme Court, you know, you're not wrong in what you're saying, but in terms of business issues, that is much more likely to be defended or corrected through the legislature than in terms of cultural issues like being pro-life. What's your response to that?
Well, I mean, look, I hear this a lot, you know, that there's a methodological consistency here. But, you know, the Federal Arbitration Act, which goes back to 1925, just doesn't have anything that would lead to decisions like the ones that the Supreme Court and that Barrett have put forward. It's just totally crazy to rewrite statute this way. So, you know, yeah, sure, you can probably correct it in statute, but who's to say that the courts won't ruin it again? I mean, the thing is there's tens of millions of dollars behind Barrett, and there are tens of millions of dollars behind Kavanaugh. There are just huge amounts of money behind these guys. And it's not because, you know, the Koch brothers care about abortion. I mean, David Koch was pro-choice. Like, they are getting – what they're getting is the rollback of government power over corporations. I mean, that's what this is really about.
Mm. And so what do we know about Amy Coney Barrett's record and what it says about her view of corporate power and also an issue that, you know, you're expert on and care a lot about, which is antitrust?
Yeah, so – there aren't a lot of cases where she's ruled on antitrust. And it's always a little bit tricky with lower court judges because oftentimes they can say, well, I'm just following precedent. I'm not really kind of making case law here. But from what I read, and I went over, I don't know, a bunch of her cases, and what I found is she has, I didn't find a single case where she ruled for a worker, for a consumer, or for a small business against a larger business. I mean, she rules on the side of the powerful. And, you know, you could say that there's a methodological consistency there, but it's not that she's, you know, following statute. It's just that she's ruling for the powerful. And that's what you just see in general with the courts nowadays.
Well, this is what I think is fascinating, Matt, which is I don't even know if this is just like a right-wing thing. I think it's more prominent on the right. But, you know, I think you pointed to, and some others did, on Justice Ginsburg and the way that she ruled in many cases whenever it came to corporate power. What is this kind of bipartisan consensus around ruling in this particular way? How did it become judicial in the first place?
Yeah, it's a really good point. I mean, Ruth Bader Ginsburg was, you know, enormously accomplished and important justice for a lot of reasons and did a lot of and as a lawyer in the 70s, she did incredibly important work for women's rights. But you're right. I mean, she ruled in favor of monopolies, in favor of stripping jurisdiction for smaller companies over larger companies. You know, it is a bipartisan thing. I mean, towards the end of her life, she started ruling in better ways in terms of antitrust. But what we're seeing is that the legislators and the public have pushed power into the courts. And that's a strategy that the Democrats like because it means that politicians don't have to take responsibility for legislating. It's also a strategy that Mitch McConnell likes because he can have his judges write the law and then he can block anything that Democrats try to do. But ultimately what's happening is that we're pushing power into the hands of the wealthy and into the hands of corporations. And that's a really dangerous thing for our democracy.
Mm-hmm. Matt, while we have you, I also wanted to just get your reaction to the Times getting a hold of, you know, more than two decades worth of the president's tax returns. What did you think was noteworthy or what stood out to you there?
Well, I mean, we know that he doesn't pay taxes. I mean, and he loses money. I mean, he's a bad businessman who doesn't pay taxes and inherited all his money. And basically, he's a con artist. And we've known that for a long time. So, you know, that's what I took away. It's kind of useful to have the information out there. I think that you know, this speaks to, I hope that Democrats make a big deal of it, because to me, it is a big deal. But at the same time, you know, if Obama had enforced the law against the powerful, if Democrats like, you know, the Manhattan DA, Cy Vance, who had Jared and Ivanka on real estate fraud years ago and let them off for a campaign donation. I mean, if we had a real Justice Department that was focusing on white collar crime, Donald Trump would never be president. And a whole bunch of people on both sides of the aisle, powerful donors and powerful politicians, would probably not be in the positions of power that they're in. So to me, this is a bipartisan problem, although I think that Donald Trump should be held accountable for not paying taxes and for what could be tax fraud.
Yeah, I mean, I took it kind of the same way, which is I was like, look, you know, this is one of those things where I guess if we can spark a conversation around the real estate deductions and the way that so many of these people actually dodge paying taxes, I'm all for it, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think we have a real problem with the rule of law. I mean, that's fundamentally what the issue is. The rule of law was a hard-won victory for the public that took hundreds of years to win. And what has happened in the last 40 years since the Reagan administration, although it has been bipartisan, is we have decided that to not enforce the rule of law against the powerful. And that's what you see over and over and over and over and over. And the dangerous thing is that the public is getting used to it and is saying, well, you know, everybody cheats and lies at a powerful level, so we don't care. And that's not a democracy. That's increasingly an oligarchy. And so we have to deal with this, but to deal with it, both sides have to admit that they were part of the problem, and both sides have to commit to actually taking on concentrated power and saying the rule of law applies to everyone.
Yeah, I think that's a really important point, Matt Stoller. Thank you so much for being with us. Thank you so much.
Matt.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Mm-hmm. Lots of new polls again, one in particular that focuses on the despair of Americans. We're going to talk about that. That's when Rising continues.